topic I chose for today's talk is leadership, inspiration and change. And I would like to, at the very outset, I would like to unpack this term of change. Change I see as a holistic phenomenon which works at three different levels. First, the belief level, action level, and attitude level. But the problem we see in different organizations is that the whole focus goes to action level, and the change at belief level and attitude level is not tapped. And the ultimate outcome is that their change is not sustainable. I think we need to know something more about this phenomenon called change. Change is developmental, which simply means that if you have learned something new and if you remain with that thing for the rest of your life, this is not developmental change. Developmental change always makes an angle, that if you have gone from status quo line up, that angle must be there throughout your life. Change is painful because the practices, the ideas which are with you for such a long time, it is very difficult to part with those ideas. So change is always very painful. Change is incremental. You shouldn't expect that everything is going to change overnight. It's a very slow process. And change is not straightforward. It's kind of zigzag process. You start with some idea, you think that this is going to happen, but in its way there are certain constraints and certain obstacles. It's always zigzag process. Change invites resistance. Now, what I'm sharing with you is based on my readings, my observations, and my actual practice as a leader. Whenever you want to bring some change, there is always some resistance from some quarters. So be ready for that. Change needs a rationale. Why should I change? So there needs to be a purpose, a cause, a reason. Now I come to my actual topic of leadership. But that background is very important because the ultimate aim is change. Some leaders are one-layered managers. They focus on just one layer of change, that is actions. And they make employees do things. Remember that in the previous slide, we mentioned that change needs a rationale. But here, these managers ignore that golden rule. They make employees do things. They use authority and fear. If you don't do this, this will happen to you. The whole emphasis is on what? Do this, do this, do this. The other two very important WH questions, how and why, they are totally missing in this kind of management. There is partial emphasis on how. That is why in this kind of paradigm, there is less emphasis on professional development, because these managers think that professional development is not a very important thing. So I call them one-layered managers. The employees do not know the why or rationale. And this is very important. The relationship between employees and manager is a master-slave relationship. The employees are always at the receiving end. They are there to receive the instructions, orders. Everything is fixed. There are structures. So there is no room for creativity. And you can imagine that if there is no room for creativity, what kind of place that would be? The workplace appears as a dull and boring place. So this is one scenario where a one-layered manager is leading some organization. Then we come to two-layered management, where one layer of action is there, and the managers who are leading the organization do have knowledge about that organization as well. In the first case, the managers don't know anything about that organization. But in this case, the manager knows about that organization. For instance, if it's a university, the manager knows about the educational dynamics. If it's a law college, the manager knows about the dynamics of law. In this case, the manager possesses knowledge relevant to the organization. How part is improved? Because that person knows about the nature of that organization. But the relationship remains master-slave relationship. And things remain fixed. Workplace is very dull and boring. But on the other hand, things are moving. Organizations are working. Right? Now, here, I'll stop here and I'll share with you a very interesting experience of reading a book on pottery. And the writer in that book gives three laws that how a piece of craft can be turned into a piece of art. Law number one, it's called law of head, that the potter in his or her head thinks about the shape of a pot he or she is going to make. The second law is law of hand. In pottery, the movement of hand is very important. Because a little twist, if you have seen process of making pots, you'll see that the wheel is moving with a very fast pace, and a little twist of hand changes the shape of the pot. So the second law is law of hand. And the writer says in that book that after applying these two laws, law of head and law of hand, a perfect dead skeleton is ready. Let me repeat. After applying these two laws, law of head and law of hand, a perfect dead skeleton is ready. And the title of this book was, the theme of this book was how to convert a piece of craft into a piece of art. Then he says, there is a third law, and that law is the law of love. When you apply this law, you know, the whole thing becomes alive. You infuse life into that pot. Now it is a piece of art. See, law of head, law of hand, after applying two laws, a perfect dead skeleton is ready. So the pot is there, you can use it, but it's not a piece of art. It becomes piece of art when you apply law of love. Right? Similarly, after applying these first two laws, some managers think that is it. Organization is running. But something is missing. And that something is that life. And for that, you have to apply the law of love. So far, we talked about two kinds of managers. First manager didn't know anything about the organization. and focused on actions only. He would make his or her employees work, do things by using authority or using fear. In the second case, the manager knew something about the organization. This means improvement in how, but still why part was missing. Now we go to the third scenario. Here is the third layer. This is a three-layered leader. Can you spot what was missing in the previous and what is present here? The attitude, the passion, the affection, the warmth, the enthusiasm, the inspiration. And here is a leader who is not driving his or her employees through fear or authority. He is inspiring them. He is igniting enthusiasm. But before he ignites enthusiasm, he himself or she herself has to be excited about things. Only then you can communicate this enthusiasm or convey this enthusiasm. First of all, this leader is excited about what he or she is doing. That is prerequisite. Now, immediately, the relationship shifts from me and you to we. It's not a master-slave relationship here. The leader himself is excited about the vision. And this is something which was missing in the previous two paradigms. The leader inspires employees through his or her vision, gives purpose, cause, meaning, and why of actions. So this is the most important line, that the leader shows the dream to his or her employees. He or she gives purpose and meaning. If you are doing this, why should you do this? See the difference in the old paradigm and this paradigm, that in the previous two paradigms, the manager had the ability to make employees do things. That's it. But in this case, the leader is doing something more. In this case, the leader himself or herself is excited about things, and he or she has the ability to make others think the way he is thinking. The leader has the ability to make others feel the way he is feeling or the way he wants them to feel. The leader has the ability to make others see things the way he would like them to see. The leader has the ability to make them dream the way he would like them to dream. And here, the driving force of action is not fear or authority, but a purpose, a dream, a cause, a meaning, and why. Now I'm adding another very interesting component to leadership. And to me, this is perhaps the most important component. And this is the fourth layer. The first layer was action, knowledge, attitude. This is fourth layer. This is creativity. A leader is always very creative, innovative. And for that, he reflects, he or she reflects deep thinking. If you want to know, you know, the details of this, read Steve Jobs' autobiography. Starting with Mac computers, iPod, iPad, and then when he joined films, you know, constantly thinking. Remember that initially I shared with you that change is developmental, always making an angle. The moment you stopped, this means that you have touched status quo line. So, for that, it's very important that leader is a thinking leader who reflects, what next, what next? You know, the beauty of dreams is that when one dream is realized, the boundary of another dream starts. When you achieve that dream, another dream starts. And that is kind of lifelong process that never ends. The leader has the courage to rock the boat, to think out of the box. And when you think out of the box, that needs a lot of courage. Because working in box is so safe. That is your comfort zone. But you, when you do something different, there is always some opposition. Here, let me share with you some initiatives very briefly from the university where I'm coming from. That in that university, we have started free education for jail inmates. And I personally visited Central Jail Quetta, Central Jail Karachi, Kot Lakhpat Jail, Adiala Jail, met with the prisoners, motivated them, and in this semester, we are having with us more than 1,000 prisoners who are getting education at different levels, free of cost. We provide them books inside the jail. We conduct tutoring inside the jail. The assessment is done inside the jail. And they are engaged in a very positive activity. Similarly, in our university, special children, any category of disability, get full fee waiver. We have another project, which is free education for dropout girls, those girls in remote areas who could not go to school for any reason. We provide them free education at pre-literacy, grade 5 and grade 8 level. Similarly, we started an accessibility center for visually impaired children. We have got software that turns text into speech. So without any other help, they wear headphones, they click any book or research paper, and that book starts talking to them. And after doing this in our headquarters, Islamabad, we have 44 regional offices. We have established these accessibility centers in 44 regional offices, which are open to non-AIO students as well. Similarly, in the last semester, we thought about a very marginalized and stigmatized segment of society, transgenders. So, Allama Iqbal Open University is the first university to announce free education for transgenders, and we are getting response. Similarly, as there are marginalized segments of society, there are some marginalized areas in Pakistan. So from next semester, we are offering free matric program to the students of Fata and Balochistan. So the purpose is that, you know, one way of doing is that you should continue with whatever is there. But as a leader, you should be thinking out of the box things, that how we can bring a change at individual level of student and at societal level. I think what a leader needs to give to his or her employees is trust, respect, and space to work. And then the magic happens. If the leader supports the employees and, you know, encourages, gives them credit, they, you know, give you back. A very simple maxim for a leader is give them the best and take best out of them. Give them the enabling environment and you'll see that how productivity is enhanced. The leader, like manager, is not just concerned about organization. The leader is concerned about organizational development as well as individual development. Because for a leader, it's very important that the employees' welfare, how they are feeling, are they comfortable, how about their professional development. Because as you say, this is human-centric leadership. This slide you have seen as first slide. This was my first slide. So I'm bringing it back again. We started with slide saying that a real change, a sustainable change, is that change which is holistic in nature, which is brought about at three levels, at belief level, at action level, and at attitude level. Because if it's at action level only, it won't sustain. There is need that there is change at belief level as well, and attitude. Only then, you know, that change is sustainable. And this is my last slide. And I'm summing it up. After showing you that holistic view of change, let's compare these two major paradigms in leadership. This is coercion versus inspiration. Some managers, they would like to get things done by using authority, by instilling fear. This is coercive paradigm of management, use of fear and force to get things done. And in this case, they touch just one layer of change, actions. The other two layers, belief and attitudes, are not touched. On the other hand, inspirational paradigm of leadership that uses inspiration, enthusiasm, as a driving force. That enthusiasm emanates from a dream, from a meaning of life, from a purpose, from a cause that is given by the leader. And then this kind of leadership touches three levels of change. The belief level change, the action level change, and the attitude level change. And in this, you know, short time, I could share with you that my own personal experience is that use of force is not the way to lead an organization. It is incomplete and misleading management style. On the other hand, this inspiration, this participatory approach, and this enthusiasm, that is the way And my personal experience is that because I am coming from a background, I was just a teacher, a writer, and this was totally a different thing for me. But my personal experience is that I found this paradigm more effective and more useful. Thanks very much.